Welcome to the third episode in our series, Learn Urbanization with Binoy Mascarenhas. Yes, it's coming out a little late in the week, but that's because I've been trying to teach myself the art of editing a video, and it has been slow going. Sorry about that. This episode was a whole lot of fun. Binoy, well, let's just say Bhai Saab is not a fan of the Mumbai Coastal Route project. In this episode, he tells us why he's not a fan and why, as it turns out, he's also not a fan of cars, Robert Moses, the Pune University flyover, flyovers in general actually, and other things besides. Do let the both of us know if you want us to talk about other things urbanization in the upcoming episodes, and thank you for listening. Please enjoy. Mascarenhas, what's up?
Not too much, yeah. Doing well. How's it going there?
Going well. This is becoming crazier and crazier by the day. So now we are, as you might know, in a 10-day lockdown in Pune.
Yeah.
And the area that we have stayed in has been declared a containment zone. But I don't know what a containment zone is within a city that is locked down. So yeah. I'm beginning to feel like a mother.
Yeah, no one knows. We're just all winging it and hopefully it'll all be okay.
Smile and waves happens to be, I think.
Absolutely. Hope for the best. Yeah.
Hope for the best. Yeah. Speaking of hoping for the best, that I think might end up being the theme for today's talk, because we're going to talk about something that is in a way close to your heart, but not the topic itself, but the hatred for the topic.
Absolutely, yeah.
So rather than I speak about it, why don't you begin by telling people exactly what we're going to be focusing our discussion on today?
Yeah, okay. So I think what we've discussed at least is that we're going to talk about the Mumbai Coastal Road, and I'm going to try my best to approach it from a neutral perspective. At least talk about what the pros are envisaged, but then I will obviously offer my perspective on why I think that's even the pros, the way that they are laid out, are actually not going to be any advantages for the city, and why a lot of the estimates of these advantages are clearly blown out of proportion. So yeah,
that's full marks for being neutral.
Oh yeah, I know. I threw it out right at the
beginning. It lasted a long time.
But it's like passion. I mean, okay, just for the benefit, I'm born and brought up in Mumbai, so the city is very close to my heart, and I lived rather in a suburb of Bandra, which is right past where the coastal road will go through, right? So it's going to completely change the face of the neighborhood that I grew up in, and in the city that I grew up in, and lots of mud. So yeah, it is passionate. It is hard to stay neutral about a project like this, but I'm going to try and at least give the perspective of the people on the other side, and hopefully your audience can do a little bit more digging if they support the project and learn more about it from that perspective as well. Yeah.
Good. So let's back up and first give people an introduction to what we're talking about. What exactly is the Mumbai Coastal Road One, and what was the objective behind it?
Okay. Yeah. So the Mumbai Coastal Road is actually in some part already built, because one section of the Mumbai Coastal Road is the Bandra Worli Sea Link. So for those of you who are familiar with the geography of Mumbai, it's an island city, which predominantly is in a north-south directional city, where you have a lot of the residential suburbs up in the north, and the business district is down south in the Colaba Nariman Point area. So it was envisaged at some point of time that connecting these suburbs to the downtown through the internal streets was causing too many problems. The roads were not wide enough, and there was too much congestion. So in order to avoid that, they built one bridge over the Bay of Worli, which actually gives a kind of a straight line connection between Bandra to Worli. So there is already a connection, obviously, through the internal streets of the island city. But they built the shortcut, which is the famous Bandra Worli Sea Link, the cable stayed bridge that you will get all the Bollywood shots for Mumbai. That's the new representative. It's no more the Gateway of India. So that's what was built. That project, in some ways, is already a failure. And that's kind of a living testimony of what the coastal road can be and what its problems are going to be. Right? So it is one section of the coastal road. Now, what they're doing is, rather than learning the lessons from that failure, they want to extend it and increase it, hoping that when they complete the entire corridor, then the demand that they had projected back in 2000, those numbers will start
materializing.
Yeah. So what they're going to do is now build a section from Worli all the way to Nariman Point to the erstwhile business district of Mumbai. And I will come to why I call that the erstwhile business district.
Mm-hmm.
And that's one section. And then from the Bandra up north, going all the way up to Malad and beyond is what they're planning as the coastal road. Now, I just want to make one point about what this road is that some of the details actually no one knows because the government is being very secretive about it. They're so afraid of the hostile backlash that environmentalists and people who love Mumbai are putting against it that they're being very secretive about the project. So some of the details are I don't know for sure, but by and large, what is different about the coastal road and the Bandra Worli Sea Link is the Bandra Worli Sea Link is a cable stayed bridge. It extends out into the sea and it's some distance away from the sea. Whereas the coastal road will actually be an amalgamation of bridges as well as part of the some sections of that road will actually hug the coastline. It will go along the coastline itself. So actually be like a kind of a wall that blocks this access of the sea to the people living in Mumbai. So it will be like a big wall in front of the sea. And there will be some sections that will actually go underground as well. I think under Juhu Beach as well as under Malabar Hill. These are the two underground sections that are being planned. So it's an amalgamation of bridges.
When you say underground, you mean literally underground or something like an undersea tunnel or both?
So I think some part of it will obviously be undersea to eventually go underground. So I think there is a section which will go through Juhu Beach, which will be partly sand. I think it will lie around that and they will obviously build a structure around it because the sand is obviously not going to be strong enough to sustain it. But the section that is planned to be going under Malabar Hill, that section, part of it will hug Malabar Hill and part of it will actually go underground. And there's still some details that they are working on. And it keeps changing. So they're still doing some studies around it. But by and large, this is what the coastal road is meant to look like. So the point to make here is that it's not just going to be a bridge out in the sea. It's going to be an amalgamation of tunnels, bridges, and a road hugging the coastline, which is the most problematic part.
Okay. And if I understand you correctly, you're saying if I was a resident of Malad and I wanted to reach what you describe as the erstwhile business district, on the face of it, it seems as if the amount taken to travel from point A to point B will be much lower, right? Because I used to say in Santa Cruz and Andheri first, and it used to be hell trying to reach town or South Bombay.
Absolutely.
Except from
yeah, and don't get me wrong, absolutely. There will be a great benefit for the people who live along the coast who want to access a point along the coast. And it will benefit them. But Ashish, as you, as a professor of economics will know, everything has a cost-to-benefit analysis.
Okay.
Right? So you have to measure that little benefit that you're getting for some amount of people against the cost of that project. So that's when we need to start talking numbers. And I've done a little bit of my homework and I've kept some numbers ready.
Okay.
So the Mumbai Coastal Road, as per the government official latest estimate, is going to cost, I think, around 13,000 crores. Okay. To give you some idea what that number is, this section of the coastal road is 10 kilometers long. And to give you some idea of cost, the Mumbai Metro Line 3, okay, and this is the sophisticated Metro Line 3, which is completely underground, and that adds a lot to its cost. That is going to cost around 30,000 crores for 30 kilometers, right? So you have three times the cost, but three times the length. But now what is crucial is that the projected and very optimistic numbers of the Mumbai Coastal Road is around 130,000 cars per day, whereas the number for the Mumbai Metro Line 3 is 10 times that number. Okay, it's 1.3 million is the projected numbers. So you're seeing
this is what
per day, yeah,
okay.
but that's the numbers, and both these numbers pale into comparison when you actually see what is currently already being transported by the Mumbai Railway suburban railway system. If you put those three lines together, the numbers go to about 6 to 7 million passengers per day. So you have to see from that perspective. You're spending 13,000 crores of rupees for the benefit of the few people that we just mentioned who live along the coast and will travel to points down at along that coastline. This project would have probably made more sense back in the 1960s. Today, it makes zero sense. And I'll tell you why, because one of the so-called advantages of this coastal road is that it will connect Nariman Point, which was the central business district in Mumbai, to the suburbs, right? And also provide Nariman Point direct connectivity to the Mumbai airport. Mm. Now, both these points are moot in 2020. Why? Because for the last 7 or 8 years, Nariman Point's real estate value has actually been declining. There are, I believe, even office spaces that are now empty in Nariman Point because a lot of these businesses have moved to Bandra Kurla Complex, Lower Parel, Andheri Kurla. So all of these areas are now seeing a surge in their real estate value. Even so, BKC, I believe now, even per square foot is costlier than Nariman Point. So it's not a matter of this being people moving because it's cheaper. It's now people are moving to Bandra Kurla Complex because it's better. So that's one big change that is happening. So Nariman, so it's no more a great advantage to connect people to Nariman Point. The second thing is the airport connectivity. Now, if the airport in Navi Mumbai gets built, again, a lot of this envisaged numbers that you see moving up and down to Santa Cruz Airport or Andheri Airport, that will probably not happen as much. So you prefer connectivity going down towards Navi Mumbai, and that's what you call the east-west connectivity. So a lot of our investments right now are still in building north-south connectivity in Mumbai. And we have peripherally doing some east-west connectivity. We did one line, one first metro line, and we stopped at that. I mean, there's nothing.
The Andheri Goregaon link.
The Andheri Ghatkopar.
Ghatkopar, yes.
Yeah, it's officially the Varsova Andheri Ghatkopar link. And that is it's great to be an east-west connector, but they didn't connect to the airport for some reason. But anyways, apart from that, there is plans obviously to build some east-west connectors, and there have been some roads that have been built in between. So I'm not saying that they've completely neglected that aspect. But what I do feel is that east-west connectivity is going to be more important going forward than the north-south connectors that we currently are planning for.
Okay. So lots of questions in my mind, but let's begin with the simplest one. You talk of the link between Malad and Colaba or whatever the erstwhile business district was. And when you said that Bandra Kurla and Goregaon and other such office districts are springing up, it no longer is necessary to connect the two. Yeah. In a post-COVID world, your point is only reinforced. People might either choose to work from home or might not want to work in Bombay to begin with.
Absolutely, yeah. And it's right. Obviously, you can't blame them because nobody anticipated COVID.
Correct.
So they have
not
factored that into their decision making. But a lot of the jobs that would be in a place like Nariman Point or BKC are the kind of jobs that are likely to move to work from home. And the second point that you have to see is that if they continue the trend of what they are doing with the Bandra Worli ceiling, where they have forbidden motorcyclists to use it and regular buses. So I mean, they had a point when the BST city bus was using it, but I don't think that's happening anymore. So if that kind of a trend continues with the coastal road, then basically you're building a corridor for cars. And most of these car users are the ones who are likely to go to work from home. So you may not even get to that 130,000 number that they are estimating. They didn't meet that number for the Bandra Worli ceiling. They didn't meet their projected numbers. They were short by a long, long way. They tried every which way to get that number up by putting a cap on the planned increases, the toll. But none of it worked because at the end of the day, connectivity between Bandra and Worli is to the places between Bandra and Worli. It's not as important to get from one end of Bandstand to the other end of Worli. Because after you get there, then what? Then you're back into traffic, right? And so, yeah, I mean, it does benefit some number of people. I won't say it doesn't, but does it justify the cost?
Correct. Does it pass the cost benefit test?
Absolutely. I don't think so.
All right. Now, I want to frame this discussion along the lines of two people who eventually, sooner or later, come up with any discussion related to urbanization and transport. Two people who you are very familiar with. We've spoken about them multiple times in the past. But for the benefit of the audience, I will name them. I will name the city and then I'll ask you to explain their context and why we are bringing them up right now.
Yeah,
you already know who I'm talking about.
Absolutely.
So this is New York City, Robert Moses and Gene Jacob.
Yeah.
So if you could give a brief overview of why we want to talk about this city and these two people and how this links to how we can understand Bombay today.
Yeah, I think, so just for a perspective of who Robert Moses and Jane Jacobs were. So, I mean, you can look at them as like the antithesis of each other in terms of their philosophies, right? So Robert Moses came around the time when the car was actually the great innovation. What we see today as a smartphone, the car was it that time. It was the technology changer of the time. And Robert Moses reacted to that and said that urbanism can really change to fully exploit this this wonderful new technology that we have right now. So all the problems that he felt was happening in cities, he felt that if we design our cities around the automobile, we can eliminate these problems. So problems, keep in mind, from a white man's perspective back in the 1950s, a lot of that was crime, a lot of that was racial mixing, and all of these things that he wanted to get away from, right? And that aspiration leads to this whole idea of suburbia, where you can have your neighborhood of everybody who looks like you living all together and your children cycling down the streets. And you can have this little neighborhood, but then what's the point of living in a neighborhood like that if you can't access jobs? And that's where the car changes it, right? So what Robert Moses envisaged is that we can create these little clusters of neighborhoods far away from where the jobs are. And then we can provide this kind of infrastructure that makes them sort of self-contained little neighborhoods. And then we'll connect them along these major freeway systems that when you own a car, you can get onto these freeway systems and it'll take you down to the downtown in about half an hour to 45 minutes. So you can still have your access to jobs.
And I don't know if this will resonate with you, but for those of you in the audience who watched Mad Men, this is exactly what is talking about. So Don Draper used to stay in a neighborhood which looked idyllic and utopian, and he would use the train to travel to his office. And the commute, I mean, it was never explicitly mentioned, but it would last for about 90 minutes one way. So drive in your car up to the station, then sit in the train, and then reach the city.
Yeah.
That's exactly what you're talking about.
Absolutely. And I mean, this model had its advantages. It met the aspirations of what Robert Moses envisaged. I think he wanted to create this kind of contained area where people felt safe, where you had all these family-oriented amenities that were in walking distance around you. You had your school, your shopping mart, and all of that close by. Keep in mind, they were still not in walking distance. You still need to take your car out of it. But basically, you had your access to open spaces and nature because of how spread out and low density living you could achieve when you had an automobile-oriented approach. Now, the flip side of these things is that living within these neighborhoods were great for the people, and not really great, but they met those benefits quite well of having those self-contained lifestyles. But it resulted in creating these great isolated systems, right? So you had one neighborhood which had good connections within itself, but it was very poorly connected to neighborhoods in its immediate vicinities. So just if you wanted to go to like one neighborhood down the road, you would have to take your car out. There was very poor walking connectivity between these two neighborhoods. That is the kind of model of suburbia development, which forces one to use a car. It doesn't give you the option of walking or using any other mode of transport. You have no other means but to hop onto your car.
Yeah.
Now, Jane Jacobs, when she wrote this great book, The Death and Life of American Cities, I think, when she wrote this book, at that time, her ideas were considered crazy. They were considered going against the tide, and because what she was actually doing was questioning this whole model, and she was anticipating repercussions that had not yet happened. She was saying that this will have a negative impact on children. It will lead them to be more sedentary, there will be more depression, because that your whole reason why you live in communities is to access people, right? And she says that living in these isolated neighborhoods where we are in these cars. They will act like self-contained cocoons where we will not be able to interact with each other. So she was talking about urbanism from a human perspective and not from an engineering perspective. And every urbanist at that time, it was obviously a male-dominated sector, like most sectors were back then. Obviously, wrote her off as this kook who had no idea about the technical and engineering ideas of the time. But they had to come around because what she said and what she envisaged would happen actually happened. A lot of these cities that were supposed to be these beacons of economy turned out to be dead cities. I mean, the classic examples of what's happening to the Detroits and all of that of the world, right? Because you're, at the end of the day, you're creating these places that are so isolated that people only come there for the purpose of work or for getting something done. They had no connection to the city anymore. And that disconnect created problems in multiple layers. It created problems of picking us lazy. We need cars to get everywhere. So problems of obesity, all of that are sort of we're clamped now to petrol and gas. We can't see ourselves getting out of these problems. So our whole dependence on the oil industry becomes a lot more now. Yeah. So that's
the parallels to me are painfully obvious, but just in case they aren't to anybody listening, let me draw them. When you think about the coastal road, this is exactly what New York was going through about 50 to 60 years ago.
Absolutely.
So you're talking about huge investment that enables cars to go from point A to point B. By definition, point B becomes an office district, point A becomes suburbia.
Yeah.
And it's almost as if we are repeating history in a sense in Bombay. When New York could tell you that, boss, we've been through this, we've done that, and this is not a good idea.
Exactly. Which is why I said that in the 1960s or 70s, this project would probably have made more sense. And it was actually envisaged back then, right? It's just taken 50 years like most things in India do. In 2020, this project makes zero sense, and no global city, if you go to any of those global cities that are ranked by, I think, the Merco Index and all of these indices, no global city worth its salt is doing anything remotely close to augmenting their car infrastructure. They are all going the other way. You see, you talk about the Parises, the Londons, the New Yorks. Every city is thinking about strategies to reduce their dependence on cars and figure out ways to get cars out of their downtowns and their business districts. And for some reason, Mumbai is still caught up in outdated ideas of the 1960s, where we are thinking about ways to get more cars into our downtowns. And I don't know, it's the craziest idea.
So this might set you off on another of your little speeches, and I mean that in the nicest way possible. But say, for example, congestion charges for parking in London's inner districts, and Hidalgo's work for promoting the use of cycles in Paris are just two examples that come to mind. But it's like you said, you travel to any global city and the idea is to move away from cars and either towards bikes or just make cities more inherently walkable.
Yeah.
And not just Bombay. Let me bring up now my city. And this is something that drives both of us equally mad. As you might know, they're pulling down the Pune University flyover right now. The good news is they're going to build one new flyover, which is for the metro, which maybe you can argue in favor of. But the other part of the flyover is, once again, like you said, it's just to have cars move from point A to point B. And as a lay person, I can't help but ask this question, using the same cost benefit thing that you spoke about. Can't we just use the money that we would have used to build that flyover in augmenting our public transport capabilities? What is the point in building a flyover, especially when the first one, which took about 4 years to build and lasted for less than 13 years, now needs to be torn down? It's like we are hell-bent on not listening to history.
Absolutely. So, and even if you want to leave aside public transport, suppose, let's, for argument's sake, say we don't believe in public transport. We only want to solve congestion from the perspective of car users. Let's be very narrow in our focus, just like they are being. Even from that perspective, I think flyovers are a bad idea.
Elaborate on that. Why would you say that?
First, let's look a little bit of precedent, right? I mean, you've traveled a fair bit outside India, and I've also had a few opportunities in that sense. Tell me, how many cities outside India have you seen that have flyovers? You might see a lot of elevated freeways, and that's a different picture. But I'm saying how often do you see a flyover, which is like basically a bridge over one intersection? How?
So literally off the top of my head, I mean, based on my personal experience, sorry, Singapore, no, Kuala Lumpur, no, Paris, no, Toulouse, no, Lyon, no.
Yeah, you might find a few examples in Southeast Asia. I think there are a few in Kuala Lumpur, but your point is that outside this in Europe, in North America, you will never see this used as a solution. The reason is very simple. It comes down to cost benefit. The cost of doing this project, it easily goes to about 100, 150 crores for doing this one intersection. You're solving the problem only for that one particular intersection, but you're not solving the problem for the entire traffic circulation, because you're just moving that problem one intersection down the line, right? So if I go quicker over one intersection, what that is doing is actually aggravating the problem further downstream, because you have a quicker flow upstream, then it all comes down to a constrained spot and you create a bottleneck. That is exactly what we are seeing with all the flyovers that are being built in Mumbai. I'll use Mumbai as an example because I'm most familiar with it, but that are these upteen number of flyovers that were built, right? On this, if you're familiar with the Phoenix Mall, is the Tulsi Pipe Road, built these flyovers. All that does is that pushes the problem a little bit further and exemplifies the problem that it's pushed further. The second thing with why flyovers are bad is that not everyone who's at that intersection wants to go past the intersection, right? There is traffic that needs to turn under the intersection. Now, if your right of way, that's basically your road width, is not wide in the first place to begin with, the moment you put a flyover, then you're narrowing the width and the number of lanes that are available for turning under the flyover.
Correct.
And so that aggravates congestion, which is what you see happening everywhere. Like if you look at the flyover, for example, that goes over the Western Express Highway in Mumbai, at Andheri, right? Now, this flyover allows you to move from Borivali to Bandra quickly, but most of the traffic on that particular intersection want to turn right because they have to go to the bloody airport, man. So to go to the airport, you have to wait through three signals, which is the most important point you want to connect. But for the others, you put the flyovers. So it doesn't make any sense the way they have thought of these things. And flyovers, as a general rule, create more problems than they solve. Not to mention that they're ugly as hell. They spoil the urban character of the city. And they create so many other problems along with it.
And on a related note, one that we haven't spoken about so far, but another problem with flyovers, with the coastal road, with the vision that Moses had, and again, this is something that I know is going to probably raise your blood pressure, so my apologies.
But I will say one thing about Moses. Yeah. Moses would probably have hated the concept of a flyover, because freeways and flyovers are fundamentally different things.
But I'm guessing he would... One criticism that you can apply to both Moses and all the projects that we are speaking about right now is it's almost as if you've forgotten that people also walk.
Absolutely. And
expand on that, please.
Yeah.
Pedestrians.
See, the big problem that I have with the coastal road is that we are willing to spend 13,000 crores on a project that is going to benefit less than 1.5% of Mumbai users. And I, while preparing for this call...
What percentage did you say? I need to emphasize on this in the notes.
1.5% of Mumbai's traffic moves by cars. And this is the number. This is official MCGM numbers, right? So if even... And we spoke about this before. Even by the most optimistic estimate, if you just want to sort of squeeze the numbers and massage it the best way you can, you'll get to about 8%. But beyond that, the reality is most Mumbaikers either walk or use public transport or use a combination of taxis, rickshaws, and the likes. So car users, predominantly not happening. But keep in mind the flip side. Almost 80% of the traffic volume will be cars, because a car occupancy is 1.2 people on an average. But a bus has about 40 people on an average. So the number of vehicles that you see on the street will be mostly cars. But the number of people that are being transported, it's your trains, your buses, and followed by your rickshaws and walking. Don't forget walking. And the thing about walking infrastructure is that And why I want to bring this point up is every time when people like me criticize the coastal road, the argument that is put from the government is this coastal road is you all are focusing only on the highway. You are not focusing on these great promenades and public spaces that we are creating along the coastal roads, which will be a haven for walkers and children and senior citizens will come and jog there and do whatever. So one thing is they are not understanding what the difference between leisurely walking and commuter walking. They are completely two different things. Nobody's going to walk on the coastal road to get from one part to the other. The second thing is, even as leisure spaces, okay, I want you to just, I wish we could have done some satellite images on this call, but if you look at, and we can share links later, but if you look at this, the Bandra Reclamation Promenade, which was created as an extension of the Bandra Valley Sea Link, if you look at a satellite image of that promenade, it looks quite beautiful. I mean, it's wonderful. It's got nice gardens. It's got a lovely place to walk. It's got a nice wall on which you can sit and look at the sea. And it's it can be a very beautiful space. But yeah, if you actually go to that space, it's completely dead. It's unsafe to go closer to sunset. There are hardly any people. Most of the people out there are like either they're doing drugs or whatever. There are other issues to that you have with problems for that coast. Oh, brilliant. Wow, I didn't know you could do this yet. So yeah, so that's the promenade that you see there. I think it's the green path that you see along the Western Express.
Love Mumbai bit, yes.
Yeah, so the Isle of Mumbai is a structure that has been put out there. But this promenade, you can see it's right by the sea, right? But now, okay, this is great actually. If you can just zoom in out there.
Sure.
Yeah, so the problem with this promenade is comes down to just one simple point. It's access, right? To access this promenade, which is a good 1.5 to 2 kilometers long, there are only two points of access. One goes through a slum and the other goes through the same access that you would use to get onto the freeway that takes you to the Bandra Valley Sea Link. So you'll have to cross all those lanes of traffic, go under the flyover, under the freeway system. So under these 8 lanes, they have built like a subway, which is filled with dirt and smells of urine and all of that. So you have to go through all of that to access this. And you can already see this photograph shows it quite clearly that the coastal, this promenade is already not as active as it could have
could
been.
Could have been, should have been, yeah.
Looking good. So it looks nice in plan. All of these things look great in plan. But now you compare the same promenade with the Bandstand Promenade or the Carter Road Promenade, which is just a few kilometers away from this. Mm-hmm. These spaces are live, they are vibrant, they are much older, so they don't have all this fancy infrastructure that is there on the Bandra Valley, the Reclamation Promenade. But these spaces are a lot more used and a lot better, purely because of access. All you have to do to get to these spaces is cross a narrow street to get to them, right? So they are extremely accessible, extremely walkable. There's a lot of amenities that have developed, both formal and informal, along these promenades. You have your Belpuri Wala, your Chai Wala, all of these things that can actually come. And these are the things that will come because there are, so it's like a give and take. I mean, sorry, it's like they feed each other, right? Because people are coming, commercial activities happen, and because commercial activities happen, more people come. So it actually feeds off each other, which you don't get with the Reclamation Promenade. So even though they're creating these nice public spaces, I feel they'll all be dead spaces.
Can I ask you a question that is slightly random, but mm-hmm. one that I have always wondered about? So as you know, I spent some time in Boston about 10-15 years ago, and let me show you now the Charles River Esplanade. So like I showed people on who watching this, the Bandra Reclamation. Now let's take a look at the Charles River Esplanade. And can you walk us through why this is better, worse, or the same?
Okay, I haven't been to Boston, but yeah, I
can try. Just in theory, like I said, this is completely random off the top of my head. But I used to love while I was there, just walking over the banks of the river. And it somehow seemed much more, like you said, full of people and more walkable.
This looks good because what is very visible in this one picture is clearly there seem to be a lot more access points. I mean, that in itself shows you that where the Reclamation Promenade fails and where this is probably doing well is the access points, right? There seem to be a lot more places where one can enter and exit the promenade. The second thing is that you have to see what it connects with, right? So the reclamation promenade abuts an 8-lane freeway, right? So who would be going there is will only be going there in a car to get somewhere else. There is no place to park your car and to get off and to go onto the promenade. And so it's obviously going to be a dead space. But the same thing that you do at the reclamation promenade, there is so much of activity around it, and you have residential neighborhoods around it, that you can walk to those spaces. Or even if you live a little further down, you can take a rickshaw or a bus to get there. Right. But you can't do that with the reclamation promenade, even if you wanted to. So that that is primarily the problem. Another point that, I won't go too much into detail about this because again, it steps out of my area of expertise, but another thing that a lot of environmentalists have pointed out, which is wrong with the reclamation promenade, and which is good about the Bandstand, the Carter Road ones, is how we access our sea, right? Now tell me, what is the greatest asset for Mumbai? It's obviously the Arabian Sea, right? I mean, half the reason why the real estate prices in Mumbai are much higher than most of the rest of the country is because we have this seafront and this accessibility and all of that to it. Now, if you put a big wall in front of the sea that people can't really access the waters, then you're taking away the number one asset of that city. And yes, you can put those promenades out there, and we already discussed why those promenades are going to be problematic because they will not be accessible for people. The other problem with the promenade is that if you go to the reclamation promenade, you have a wall and then you have deep waters. So if you fall off the wall, you fall into deep waters. Now, the difference with the Bandstand promenade to some extent, the Carter Road promenade, is you can access the sea not just with your eyes, but with your feet, with your hands. You can go into the waters. And that's also an important aspect of public spaces, right? So yes, they will build another promenade along the coastal road, but that will push you further into deep waters, both literally and figuratively. And that's going to create its problem because you are not going to have that ability to just step out and put your feet in there. You're not going to be able to have your kids sit on that wall, and you're going to have like a deep waters into it, right? So it's not going to be the same that you have when you have like the rocks that you can get onto, the little bit of the beaches that are there in the Koliwadas and all of that. All of that is likely to go away. And there are some points of the coastal road where I'll give them that they have at least been cognizant of some of the criticism that has come up. So they've decided to push certain sections away from the coast, the Juhu Beach section being a good example, and so about Bandstand as well. But imagine this, right? You've seen the iconic Bandra Fort in Bandra. There was this Bollywood movie, I'm forgetting which one it was, but there's a lot of shots that are done out there. All of these shots now where you see the ocean and you see your hero, your heroine looking at the sunset. Instead of looking at the sunset, now they'll be looking at this bridge, and not even a nice looking bridge. It'll just have the pillars and the structure. So not even like the cable stayed bridge that you have at the Bandra where you're sitting. It'll just be looking like looking at a flyover, and there'll be no sunset that you can see. You'll be looking at the structure with cars zooming out ahead. And is that a price to pay? I mean, it's hard to put a monetary price onto this. I mean, we can do all the cost benefits in the world, and ultimately it's going to go down into emotional territory. Yeah. But I don't know. I don't think it's something that you would want to price. A lot of people in the developed world have actually realized that there is a price to it, and they have pulled down freeways. I can give you examples in San Francisco where they pulled down a freeway system that was connecting into the downtown near the coast. They realized that the coast is much more important to them. So they corrected the mistakes that they made 40 years ago. Seoul is another great example that they pulled down a major freeway system that was built along a water canal in the city. They tore that down and they replenished the canal and rebuilt the public spaces around it. And it's another great example of what cities are doing to correct the mistakes that they made back in this last century. We in India, unfortunately, are still bought into these old ideas, and it might take probably our children's generation to correct it and tear down the coastal road. Who knows? It might just have to happen.
Okay, so Just one more question before we wrap up today's episode. But before we do that, a quick summary. So you are opposed to the Bombay Coastal Road for a variety of reasons, one of which is cost, the other of which is the amount of time it will take. And by the way, the numbers that you have cited are the official estimates. Nothing has ever happened in line with estimates. It's almost certain that it will go over. Yeah. There's not a criticism specific to Mumbai. Any city, anywhere in the world, there will be cost overruns. Yeah. One. Second, the fact that you're connecting point A to point B and point B itself doesn't exist anymore. So there are multiple office districts that have sprung up. Third, this is a car-centric project, and that, using the reference of Jane Jacobs, isn't how you want to design cities in the first place. And there's numerous evidence points from the world over. Next, the fact that this doesn't optimize for pedestrians. And perhaps most important of all, it just ruins the natural beauty that Mumbai city in particular is endowed with. Are all points that you want to use to buttress the argument that we shouldn't be building the coastal road in the first place?
No, I think you've done an excellent job in summarizing these points. I think these are broadly the arguments that people like me have been making against the coastal road. Mm-hmm. In many ways, now we are still fighting a battle that is lost, because our last hope was the Supreme Court putting a stay on that. But then that also seems to have gone, but people are still fighting it, even though its construction work has technically started. The hope is that the coastal road is still envisaged as sections that are being built, right? So if we can actually stop some of the sections getting built and they build only part of it, I think that is probably some of the battle that will be won. What's really sad to know is that some of our iconic structures, like the Haji Ali monument, the Dargah, as well as the Mahalakshmi temple, all of your sea view that was there around that is going to go now. You're going to have this ugly cloverleaf interchange that is there right at the Haji Ali. Imagine that, right? I mean, this is one of your iconic structures of Mumbai, and you're going to have that place right out there. So I hope we are able to fight it, and I hope people, now I'm not there anymore, but I hope the activists that are there continue to challenge it. And we have a new government in Mumbai. I hope they are able to see that this is not the best way to spend their money. Yeah, that's all I can hope for.
Okay. So, Bombay Coastal Road, probably not a good idea. And we referenced the flyover in Pune in part in this episode. In the next episode, how would we flip the question around? So, what if somebody were to say to you, all right, chalo, theek hai, you think that the coastal road is a bad idea, you think flyovers are a bad idea. Can we envisage an alternative world in which flow of traffic in the city is optimized without these massive infrastructural investments? Yeah. What can be done? So perhaps in the next episode, a what if episode, where you are given the right to magically wave a wand and say, you know what, this is what transport should have looked like in Bombay and Pune.
Yeah, I think, and it's a good segue. I think what we can talk about in the next episode is how can we be better in managing traffic? And there are two aspects to that. One is obviously managing the circulation of traffic better. And that comes into intersection planning and signal design and all of that. So the second thing is, how do we approach traffic? And a lot of the way that we currently approach traffic is we take it as a given that there will be traffic. So we need to plan for how do we fight and make sure that the traffic is most smooth flowly. But a lot of what research is showing, and a lot of the experience of other cities is showing, is that if you plan your city for cars, this is a very famous quote, it's not mine, but it's a quote that says, if you plan your city for cars, cars will come. But if you plan your city for people, it will get people, right? So no matter how much you augment the infrastructure, it's not going to ever be enough. You'll always be playing this catch-up game when it comes to cars. So this whole new thinking of how do we reduce our dependency
on the automobile
and traffic circulation. So then it goes into a larger thing about traffic demand management, and not just about traffic optimization. So we can talk about these two aspects in our next call. And then there's a lot of interesting work that is happening now around using technology and the whole thing, which you'll be really like, what they're using data and big data to make better traffic management decisions. There's a lot of great work happening in this space. And yeah, that'll be something exciting for the next call, hopefully.
Hopefully. So cool. All right. So in the next episode, we speak about how to, like I say, wave a magic wand and have Mumbai and Pune look the way you would have wanted it to look.
Yeah.
As opposed to the problems that we highlighted today, in the next episode, we propose what the solutions could potentially be.
Yeah. I think that sounds
awesome. Like a good idea. Binoy, thank you so much.
Thank you. This is great. Yeah. See you next time.
Yep.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Thank you for watching this video. We hope you had as much fun listening to it as we had fun recording this particular episode. If you have any specific questions or comments either for Binoy or for me, please let us know in the comments below. Binoy can be found on LinkedIn fairly easily. Literally just type in his name and he should pop up. You can follow my blog econforeverybody.com where I'm up to a whole host of other stuff besides. Catch you in the next episode, and thank you so much as always for listening.